the chair as vice chair. Any other substitutions?
Not for councillor Buckley. Got councillor Lesley Rennie here in place of councillor Paul Pace.
Now, the next section is declarations of interest. I ought to declare that until the 3rd of October, I think it is, I'm still a member of CWP. I've made three successive terms of 3 years, but I still need to declare an interest. Are there any other members with interest that wish to declare, please? Councillor Norbury.
It also works for the adult social services.
Transfer into this unit for further assessments to that is virtually 100% all the time. And that's, as I say, is down to flexibility and approach. I guess the features in terms of onward transfer from community teams to beds still exist within this bed facility on the passenger side. There are great demands on the social care market, and we're trying to access the same pool of resources to get patients out of this particular facility as the rest of the beds across the world. So some of the things that you see highlighted, particularly in the graphs, in terms of length of stay of individual patients awaiting housing issues, social care assessment, that is a uniform challenge for the entire system. As I say, the thing for me is that it's the key point around occupancy level of time. And I think when we move on to section 5 and beyond, you can see that within the tables that exist there, you can see quite high satisfaction levels from patients present on that ward, and in terms of some of the key performance indicators that we have driven into the contract, there's a high degree of compliance with those since the onset. So for us, it is an effective unit. It is not a cheap unit, but it is undergoing a review as part of a wider health system where we are reviewing all 110 plus beds in the community, plus the 30 beds at GDU, to understand whether or not there's the opportunity to either adopt different models across that larger bed base, or potentially rationalise and achieve some high degrees of satisfaction and compliance with some of the commission standards that exist across them. As I said, the extremely positive response that we take back from the patients is probably the key factor for myself. In terms of the wider issues of optimised healthcare, they are part of a quite complicated group structure of holding companies, investment companies from the US, etc., with various separate components to their makeup. We have assurance both from Tamaris and from the National Health Services Commissioning Team that despite some of the headline news that exists across the group level, this particular healthcare sector of the overall business is financially viable and is being sold off as part of a debunking of that wider group, that this is seen as a real going concern for us. When some of the more recent press announcements came about the viability of the wider company some months ago, we entered into some immediate discussions with the company where assurances were given, and indeed we received those same assurances from the medical director of the NHS that we should not enter into any alternative arrangements at this point, but should any deterioration in service arise, we should immediately escalate to them who would pick up the wider issue with the group. The fear at the time was that with the adverse publicity that was out there, is that many of the staff employed by that company may seek employment elsewhere. That's not something that we've seen. The staffing levels have been maintained, and throughout the more recent months, there has been no impact in terms of their reductions or anything like that. We've had to cope with it. It still functions as it was commissioned back in November last year. It's a 2-year contract. It's obviously due or up for consideration and renewal in November 2020. As I've already said, ahead of that, we are taking underway the wider system bed review, and any decision to extend that contract will be taken in the context of how the wider health and social care economy views the most effective model.
Okay, first, Paul, forgive me if I just want to make sure I heard properly something you said, Mr.
social care partner colleagues across the health and social care system. We do not employ social workers.
Thank you. And final thing, again, just to understand that everyone probably got the same question. Colleague feedback in your section 5.3. Colleague feedback score, the red, greens and amber. Who are the colleagues that are giving this feedback? Is this an internal inspection or staff thing? That's what they think of the service?
Yeah, that colleague feedback will be the hospital team, the social work team, maintenance. It's basically, you know, colleague, employee colleagues across the system. That's in there directly. Acceptance of patients onto the ward.
percentage that actually is, because that's hard to see on the diagram. And then on 5 again, so it is general follow-up from what you said. There are more than one tier admitted into this ward, aren't there? Can you tell us who those teams are, and do they have the same criteria for admission? Each one of them have the same criteria for admission? Because I wonder if that ties in with that big rain.
Yes, so I'm sorry, I don't have the size volumes, but I think you can see from that pie chart that most of the patients, as you would expect, that come into hospital, most of them do go straight from hospital to home. That's. But this is the proportion of patients that do require some level of ongoing health social care. This isn't the total discharges from hospital, it's just the discharges from the GPU. So I think on general, there's about half the patients that come out of GPU require a care for at home and a package of care, and probably about 35% or so go on to requiring some level of residential nursing care, both short and long term.
Because the criteria for going there is that they will be people who will require something to get them back to their own home. That's how it's explained to us. But it does seem that there's quite a large percentage, although it's a minority percentage, are not actually doing that when you're taking the residential nursing care and there's a TTOA beds. And I'm just wondering which teams actually can admit into there, and do they all have the same criteria? Because it seems to be that either people deteriorate, their health path changes for some reason, and I'm just wondering what it is.
So the team that manages all the discharges into these types of facilities is called the IB team, Integrated Discharge Team. That's comprised of hospital employees, nursing discharge coordinators, social care workers, provided by the local authority or the community trust, and they do joint as the clinician decides that they're medically optimised. The IDT takes over in terms of the next stage of planning for those patients. The criteria for those type of patients will be uniform because it's the same clinicians making the same decisions about them. Where they go to is where the variability comes into it, because we have to fill in what's called a TOC, a transfer of care form. So that's a complete document provided by social care and the nursing and their doctors. And that TOC form is then sent off to all the providers of these types of units. And they're able to make a decision on whether or not they wish to accept the patients or not. Now that isn't necessarily that they can have different views of the types of patients that they would want to accept, or they may have different abilities to accept patients based upon their own existing residence or their own staffing levels. And that's where we see the variability. So some nursing home providers, we are quite acutely aware, struggle to accept some types of patients. Some of the homes readily accept a higher acuity of patients. The GDU, there is no limitations. They will accept anybody, but they are contractually bound to accept patients in the sense that they can't turn down on top form. They have to accept it. And that's why we're having this wide discussion about what is the most effective model for the Wirral community.
So, can I just go back to that because I'm not quite clear now? So, are you saying that they have to accept anybody regardless of their perceived outcomes by clinicians or others? Or they take
these are not, this is not a rehabilitation law. This is not, it's not the type of law where...
No, we understand that. Yeah. You just explained to us that it was for people who needed the minimum to get them back home. But whilst they were elsewhere, they were in kind of bedlocking, if you like, which is a horrible phrase. But they didn't really need that level of long-term of care at that time. They needed to be tailed off, and that's why this ward was there. But I'm just concerned that the Grey and Muster are quite a big size, may well be able to...
So these are transferred to assess beds. So this is a patient that requires a level of assessment by different health and social care professionals that historically would have been taking place whilst the patient was still resident on an acute ward. The purpose of, and therefore staffed and cared for by acute hospital staff. This, like the other beds, is a way of discharging the patient from medical care into a different setting so that those assessments can be provided using a different care model. So that would, you know, that would be protocols, GP input, etc. But they're no longer part of the hospital.
So I'm now confused entirely because I thought that the discharge team did that. So they would send them there.
Yeah, so the discharge team are involved in the collation of all the necessary paperwork and some assessment to find out whether or not they're suitable. They then go into these discharge to assess beds or transfer to assess beds, where further assessments are done both with the community patient's home, what adaptations may need to take place within that home, whether or not they need some more assessments in terms of residential, 24-hour care, etc. So there's always some level of assessment from the point of medical optimisation to take them into the unit, but the expectation of the model is that a patient would spend approximately 4.2 weeks in that type of unit before they're being transferred onto some other level of care, either at home, in a nursing home, with a package or direct to home. But the theory is that it would take 4.2 weeks out of their stay on an acute hospital.
Thank you.
I saw Councillor Cottier
from
Wyatt County, who's doing it.
Christina's kind of stolen my thunder yet again, and you've answered some of my questions, but you spoke earlier about the business behind Four Seasons. Does their business plan have any bearing on admission criteria? Does their business model affect the admission criteria for this the GPU? I know you've explained about the teams who, you know, the admission teams from acute wards who would ask the GPU to take these people on, and but you've not explained anything about the criteria from the GPU. What are you all willing to accept as the correct criteria for yourselves? Basically, my question is, you know, does the business model have any bearing on the admission criteria?
I hope I can answer that. I mean, I think what we have here is that, you know, it was our service need that we contracted for, which we put out for tender, and various organisations submitted a bid as to whether or not they could provide that. So it was up to us to write the criteria and the way in which we would want that to work. That was pretty much the standard NHS standard contract for facilities of this nature. What we did was we enhanced it to include some components of, we would hope to have access 24 hours a day, and various other features like that. And also we changed the financial model for remuneration. So the model that exists, not only in Wirral but widespread, is that the providers of these beds out in the community are paid a flat fee per bed, regardless of whether or not that bed
Who does the due diligence on the private companies? Is it yourself or an independent?
So, the first question, sorry, yes, this paperwork is about compliance against the contract that we have with Four Seasons providers. It doesn't try to draw any benchmarking across the other beds that exist within the community other than what I've verbalised to you. But that is a piece of work that we're undertaking in the social care system at the moment. So we are looking at occupancy levels, access, satisfaction across the whole range of the 140 subjects included in this, with a view to determining whether or not we can adopt the best of different models or the best of different provisions, or maybe even rationalising the number of sites that exist on the current main sites at the moment. So we're undergoing that review at the moment as a wider system. But this was specific on the commission this unit.
Just come back on that, Chair. Yeah, but when you're giving your report to, like, to this committee, we have to have something to benchmark that against. Are you doing well? Are you not doing well? Is there some parts that you could improve? We don't know that because we can't see a benchmark against any other company that's doing something similar. And give us an idea of how you are actually doing. It's proof to the likes of this committee.
So I guess that, you know, the step by rural hospitals to commission beds of this nature doesn't follow the traditional route. That's traditionally been commissioned by local authority and CCGs. But increasingly, that traditional route is beginning to change. And as I say, a year ago, this was unique to the Cheshire and Merseyside patch, but I now know of three other sites in Southport, Aintree and East Cheshire that are considering the different approach. As indeed integrated care systems are looking at other areas like running nursing homes, etc. action is not done independently by the clients, it's done with the trust and the clients in terms of collection of data. What I was making the point to about the council knowledge is that it may be captured on a software, a tablet that's produced by tonight, but the nature of those questions and the monitoring against them, the quality checking of it, is done in partnership with ourselves and tonight, actually on board and from evidence that we see going into the contract. I couldn't sit here honestly and give you the detail of every single question that's within that, but we can certainly finish with that. In terms of coming back to your original point about if this continues to operate like this, that's not the advice that's coming from the National. What they're saying is that this is a financially viable company, that they have no immediate concerns about their resilience, despite the discussions going on around either selling new investments, etc., etc. So there is no directive coming at us to cease trading with them, if you like, or cease engaging with them. But how we engage and the quality is purely an issue between the trust and the clients.
Two comments,
sorry.
So the first question would be, what do you know about who is potentially going to be sold to as part of the developments?
I've no idea. We're talking about a major private company that, you know.
So then I'm struggling to understand how you have any confidence in the continuity of service.
So that is the point I was making, that, you know, we have it in writing from the national leadership team that are having those discussions around the viability and risk that a company collapsing. And these are a healthcare provider that exists countrywide and has quite a significant input into the world community, and not just in GEU. So we're getting, as I said, we are getting our advice from nationally that says, you know, you don't need to move to producing contingency arrangements for this. And their advice to wider NHS is, should anybody else seek to contract with this company, that they are happy for that to take place. I simply would not be party, and I don't think you probably expect working in hospital that I would be party to the organisational form or trading at national level around that company. That's just simply not part of our remit.
So can I just go back to then one of my unanswered questions just on the targets? So what are the targets within this in terms of, from your perspective, I know you're taking a top-down directive, but they must be looking at your numbers and saying, based on your numbers and based on this company's financial viability, we say continue.
No, so as I say, the national body is more around the resilience and viability of the company as an ongoing concern, and whether it's able to contract with NHS or health social care bodies. They will not be looking at the effectiveness of that service. That's down to our contractual relationship with them.
So I'm sorry, Jeff, but so who looks at these results and says,
us as the contract holder, we look at these results, and any deviation from them, we have the right to demand action plans, recovery, performance improvements. We have the right to end the contract if we're dissatisfied with the way in which they're being dealt with, the same as we would with any other supplier or services, be it supplier packages or whatever.
And so what are you benchmarking these results against to make that decision?
So we are benchmarking those results against the NHS standard contract for the provision of these types of beds.
Can you furnish us with those?
And I can give you the detail that exists within that, and also with the explanations that need to put into the contract, if you like.
And is that what's informing the green and amber?
Yes. So the basis of our quality metrics will be within the contract that they tendered for and provided, and is the subject of our ongoing quality assessments.
Okay, so can that be captured? That's what we, because I think that's what tells us exactly all of the questions, I think.
Thanks
for the report. I just wanted to question you really regarding the problems with discharge, in particular the housing issue. And I know you're working with multiple agencies, social care. How's that going, and what is the particular issue around the housing? People haven't got houses to go to.
So it can be multifaceted, you know, as you say,